Hi everyone, welcome to webinar 8 of the Data Exchange webinar series for the Targeted Early Intervention Program. In today's webinar, we're going to talk about creating cases and sessions and clients for sector development work. If you haven't already, please make sure you watch webinar number 5 before you continue with this webinar. Webinar 5 really lays the groundwork for a lot of the content I'm going to go through today, so please make sure you watch that one before continuing with this. So this webinar is focused solely on how to record sector development work in the Data Exchange. So we'll be looking at activities like sector coordination and planning, interagencies, and any other work that you might do with other service providers rather than members of the community. So there are 3 key things I'll discuss in this webinar. The first is I'll take you through a number of different examples of sector development activities, and we'll talk about how to set up your cases and your sessions for those activities. We'll also talk about who your clients are for those activities, and then we'll discuss what cannot be recorded in the Data Exchange, and I'll also show you an optional reporting tool that you can use to record any activities that don't quite fit into DEX. So, as always, in our previous webinars, I introduced everyone to this document, the Data Exchange Quick Start Guide. So this is a 5-page document that outlines the 11 key steps you need to follow to access and start using the Data Exchange. It includes links to all of the key resources you need to action each step. And as you can see on the slide, it also includes a checklist so you can keep track of what you're up to. So in each of our webinars, I've been taking everyone through each step in this document. So we've accessed our training materials, we've subscribed to the newsletter, we've created our outlets, and we've looked into our privacy and consent documents. So now we're up to steps 8 and 9. So we're going to be focusing on your data collection processes, so what information you need to collect in order to report into the Data Exchange, and how to start actually entering your data, so creating your cases and your sessions. So to get started, I just want to do a bit of a quick recap of some of the things we learned in our previous webinars. So by this stage, everybody should know what an outlet is. It is the location a service is delivered in. So outlets are the first thing you need to create before you can start reporting. Once your outlets are set up, you can then start to create your cases. So cases store information about program activities and your outlets. So you can see in the diagram on the slide, they link relevant sessions together, which then link clients together. So they're kind of like a container for a specific activity that you deliver. So once you've created your case, you can then start to create sessions. So sessions are individual episodes of service. So every time you meet with an individual client, a family, or a group, you will create a session to show that you delivered a specific activity on a specific day to a specific person or group of people. And then the last layer of data entry are our clients. So you can attach clients to a case to say these are the people who will be participating in these activities. And then you can also attach clients to a specific session to say this individual person participated in this specific activity. And as discussed in our previous webinar, you can also record a number of unidentified clients at the case and session level. We'll talk about that more in more detail as we go on. So before I start going through some concrete examples of how to set up your cases and sessions, I do want to spend a little bit of time talking about our definition of a client and what this means for the work that you do. So in the TEI program, a client is a person who receives a service that is expected to lead to a measurable outcome. So this means it is someone who participates in an activity that you deliver and you expect to see a change in that client's skills or behavior or their circumstances because of the activity you delivered. So in the Data Exchange, there are 2 different types of clients you can report. There are individual clients. So this is any individual person who participates in an activity you deliver. You will collect personal and demographic information from them, and you will also create a client record for them in the Data Exchange. The other type of clients you can record in DEX are unidentified group clients. So this is a large number of people who receive a service, and it's not practical or even necessary to collect individual client information from them. So instead, you can just record the number of people who participated in the activity. So our next slide talks about when you should have individual clients and when you should have unidentified groups. So we have been encouraging everyone where possible to collect information from individual clients. But for the kind of work that you guys do, this might only really be necessary for something like training sessions. And that is because it could be really useful to have individual outcome data for the people who attend your training sessions. So you can see if some people are learning more than others, if some people might need to attend more sessions or might need a one-on-one session or something like that. But for the majority of the coordinating and training work that you do, your clients are most likely going to be unidentified groups. So any meetings you have, interagencies you coordinate, all of those activities, you can just record the number of unidentified clients. If you want, you can have a combination of both individual and group clients as well. So if you run an interagency, there might be four people who attend every single meeting and they might not have any issues filling out an intake form. So you can create client records for them. And then anyone else who attends, you can just record them as unidentified clients. One thing that I really want to hammer home for you guys is that clients are the individual staff members who attend a session or a meeting or a workshop. If you have 12 people attend an interagency, the number of unidentified clients is going to be 12. The client count is not the number of organizations you provide support to. And this goes back to our definition of a client that we talked about previously. It has to be an actual person. We can't record organizations as clients in DEX, because that means we're not adhering to that definition. And in effect, we would actually be entering false data. So you need to make sure that when you attach a client to a session or you record the number of unidentified clients, you're talking about the actual individual people who have come to a meeting or to a training session or something like that. So now we're going to go through some concrete examples to show you how to set up cases and sessions for sector development work. So the first example we have is for an interagency. So you can see in this example, the organization has set up one case for the interagency meetings, and then they're just going to set up a session every single time the group meets. And they've also recorded the number of people who are attending those sessions as unidentified clients. So at the first session, they had 10 people, and then at the second session, they had 12. So for interagencies, we really only want you to record this in DEX if you're facilitating the session, so you're the one who's actually running the interagency, or if you've contributed substantial resources in some way to the session. So you've put together some research or some other documentation that is core to the meeting that's being run. We really don't want people to record this if they're just attending and if they're not contributing in a substantial way. And you definitely shouldn't be recording this if it's not in your contract. So please make sure you check your contract before you start to record this kind of stuff in the data exchange. The next example we have is for workshops and training. So this is a pretty basic one. In this example, the organization has run a series of program logic workshops. So they've just created one case for the workshops, and then they've created a session every time they run a workshop. And again, you can see that they've recorded some unidentified clients. They had 6 unidentified clients at their first session, but they've also recorded some individual clients. So they've got a combination of both individual clients and unidentified clients for their cases and their sessions. And again, you should only record this in DEX if you're actually facilitating the training. If you're just attending the training, that doesn't actually count because you're not delivering the service. You can only record this if you're actually facilitating the session. And as always, your clients are going to be the individual staff members who attend. Our next example is for ongoing and ad hoc work or support that you provide to service providers. So there might be some situations where you work with a specific service provider throughout the entire year, and you might provide them with lots of different support over the course of that year. Support might be in person, it might be over the phone, it might be in a planned meeting. And you can record this kind of work in DEX, like what you can see in the example on the slide. So you can create a case for the organization. So you can see our first case there, we've got B Community Center. And then you create a session every time you work with them. So you can see in this first example on the left, one of the organizations they support is a community center. The first time they met with them, they did some mentoring, and then the next time they provided some governance support. And you can see they've just entered the number of people they've met with as the number of unidentified clients. And then for the rest of the year, they will just create a new session every time they meet with that organization and provide some kind of ad hoc support. And then they've done the same thing for another organization they work with. So our second case, we've got the AAA Family Center. And again, they've just set up a session every time they've met with them. So the first session was a planning session, and then the second session was for professional development. And then again, they just create a new session every time they meet with them. It is really important to remember that if you provide this kind of ad hoc support, substantial effort needs to be put in for you to be able to count it as a session. So if you have a 5-minute conversation on the phone with someone, do not create a new session for that, because that doesn't really count as substantial effort. Your interaction with the client should be for at least 30 minutes for you to count it as a session. So the next example we have is for brokering partnerships. So in this example, we've got an organization who works with local communities to build partnerships between relevant stakeholders. So they've set up one case to capture all of this work. So you can see the case ID is Partnership Coordination 2020. And in this example, there are two different types of partnership work that this organization does. So if we look at the first session, we can see the session ID is Gov and NGO Partnerships. So this organization runs monthly sessions between the government and the non-government sector to build better relationships between community organizations, local schools, and health services. So they're going to create a session every time that group meets, and they're going to record the number of people who attend those meetings as the number of unidentified clients. This organization also runs monthly sessions to facilitate better referral pathways for clients. So they run this with local service providers in their area. So the two sessions in the middle that are titled Session ID Referral Pathways 1 and Referral Pathways 2, they're the two sessions that they've conducted so far. And they'll just create a new session every time the group meets. And again, they just record the number of people who attend each meeting. If you wanted to, you could create two different cases. You could have one case for the referral pathways sessions, and then you could have one case for the government and non-government partnerships. It's completely up to you, just so long as you have a session every time those groups are meeting. The next example we have is for facilitating consultation. So again, this is the same kind of setup. In this example, the organization facilitates consultation sessions with young people, youth organizations, and employers around barriers to youth employment, unemployment, sorry. So they've created a case for the consultation, and then they just create a session every time the group meets. And in this example, we've actually got a combination of unidentified clients and individual clients. This is because it might be really useful for in an activity like this to measure the actual outcomes for young people. For the young people who attend the sessions, it could really empower them, make them feel connected to and a part of their community, for example. Whereas the staff members or the employers you meet with, it might not be necessary to record that kind of information. So you can kind of come up with any sort of combination that you want of individual clients and unidentified clients, depending on what's going to be most useful for you. So the next example I have is for events. So we have gone through this in some other webinars that we've run in the webinar that was cases, sessions, and clients for the community strengthening stream. But I did want to include it here because I know there are some sector development organizations who also organize events. So this is a really, really simple one. All you need to do is create one case for your event and then one session as well. And you just record the number of people who attended the event as the number of unidentified clients. Recording jointly delivered activities. So this is something we get asked about quite a bit. And unfortunately, there is no one clear answer to this. It really depends on how organizations work with each other and the service type they're delivering. So instead of a really clear cut example, we do just have some general rules of thumb to follow. So if there is a lead organization, they can report the total number of clients for the activity, whatever it is, and any support organizations would just report the number of clients they engage directly. So say, for example, a lead organization has started up a prenatal drop-in center and they've brought in three other organizations to help them. So those organizations, they take it in turns to man the drop-in center each day. So the lead organization would record all of the clients who come to the drop-in center. And this is because they're managing the whole thing. They're coordinating the shifts and the service providers who are helping out. They're providing all of the resources that are necessary. They're doing everything that's needed to run the center. The support organizations would just report the number of people they meet with directly. So if they man the drop-in center one day a week, they just record the number of people they saw that day. Another rule of thumb is that if all organizations contribute equally, all service providers would record the activities they conduct. So for example, if you jointly deliver an interagency with another organization, you would both report on the interagency and how many people attended each session. This is because it's not really possible to split up the cohort in any way that makes sense at this point in time. There is, however, one exception to this rule, and that is for large community events. So anything with over 100 people. So say, for example, five organizations jointly deliver an event, 200 people attend the event, and all of those organizations have contributed equally. What we would like you to do is split the number of unidentified clients up by the number of organizations. And this is because if you all report that 200 people attended the event, it's going to inflate client numbers dramatically. It would turn 200 people into 1,000 people. And that's not an accurate representation of how many people you've serviced in the community. So we would like to see organizations split those large numbers up between them. Now, we know that in a lot of circumstances, these rules aren't going to be the greatest solution. We still are trying to figure out what works best for recording jointly delivered activities, and our advice might change over time as we do that. But for the time being, this is what we're going with. And as more data gets reported into DEX, then we can figure out what the best solution may be, and we can provide more advice as needed. So that was the last example that I wanted to go through about how to set up cases and sessions. Now I want to spend a little bit of time talking through what cannot be recorded in a data exchange. So earlier we talked about who a client is in the data exchange, and you can see the definition on the screen in the blue box again. When we record an individual client or an unidentified client in the data exchange, we must adhere to this definition. So a client must be an individual person who receives a service as part of a funded activity that is expected to lead to a measurable outcome. So this definition has implications for what we can and can't report in DEX. So the first thing is that you cannot record activities that are not funded under the TEI program. A lot of you will have funding from a number of different government departments or different organizations under different grants or programs, whatever it may be. When you record information in the data exchange under the TEI program activities, you need to make sure you are only recording activities that you have been contracted to deliver for the TEI program. This means some of you will need to check with your manager or your director or your CEO, whoever it may be, to find out what activities you deliver are funded by TEI to make sure you're not recording activities that we don't fund. The next few examples on the slide are website visits or hits, document downloads, newsletters you send out, radio shows, social media posts. Unfortunately, you cannot record this work in the data exchange. This is because you can only record activities if you have provided a service directly to a client and that interaction has led to a measurable outcome. So, for example, if you distribute a newsletter or a resource to 200 people via your mailing list, you cannot count this activity. This is because you do not know if the person receiving the email is a client. It could, for example, be a DCJ staff member or an old employee. And you do not know if the people who received the email have genuinely engaged with the content. You might be able to see who opened the email, but that doesn't mean that they read it or any of the other documentation you've sent them. What you can do instead is you can use the sector development optional reporting tool to record this information instead. So this resource is available on the TEI website. It's on the key TEI resources page at the very bottom. So make sure you scroll all the way down. And this is just a Word document with a few tables that you can use to supplement the information recorded in the data exchange. So you can use this to provide more information about the interagency you facilitated or the training sessions you ran. And you can use this to report activities that can't be recorded in DEX. So you can talk about your monthly newsletter and how many people it goes to, your social media posts and how much engagement you got on them. You could also talk about other resources that you developed, any sort of work that doesn't fit into the data exchange. This tool is optional. You don't have to use it. You might have your own reporting tool that you use or spreadsheets that you fill out each quarter, whatever it may be. You can use them instead and you can use that to report on those activities. And if you do want to use this tool, it is flexible. So you can adjust the template to better suit your organization and the work that you do and to report what you want to report on. As always, if you have any advice on how to improve this, please let us know. We want to make sure that it meets your needs as much as possible, so we're happy to make any changes that are needed. So this is what the tool looks like. The first section is just a description of the activities you deliver. Part two is where you can describe the work you did and the outcomes you achieved. So you can include the purpose of your activities, the outcome you're working towards, what was actually delivered, the status of the work, because it might be ongoing, and the outcomes you achieved. And then the last part is an opportunity to provide some additional information about the work you've done. So achievements you want to highlight, any challenges you might have faced, and any additional comments you have. So again, this tool is flexible. You can adapt it to better suit your needs. Please feel free to add in extra stuff, move things around, whatever you prefer. So here are some really useful resources to help you guys get started if you haven't started entering your data into the data exchange yet, or if you're still struggling to figure out what you can and can't record into the data exchange. So on the left are resources that DCJ have developed. Please download these and have a read. They include countless examples of how to record information in DEX and what to record, more examples than what I've gone through today. So if you ever need any help figuring out how to organize your cases and your sessions, please take a look at the examples in those resources. And we update these documents all the time as well. So if you ever get stuck, please hop onto our website and have a look, because there might be some new examples in there for you. And then on the right are all of the resources DSX have developed. So these walk you through how to navigate the data exchange platform. So when it's time to create your first case and your first session, you can take a look at those task cards and learning modules, and that'll walk you through how to do it. And as always, here are all of the different places you can go to for help. So there's the data exchange website and the DSX helpline. You can always go to the TEI website to find all of our resources, or you can email us at tei@facts.newsouthwales.gov.au. Thanks, everyone.